the show talking about what LeBron said, that, you know, we want to play basketball. I'm ready to play. The Lakers are ready to play. And then I asked the question, how many people that are out of it, would they really want to come back for a 9 or 10 game spurt to the end when they really have no chance of making the playoffs? And, you know, we kicked it back and forth, and our guest here didn't come on specifically for that, but I'm sure that he has a take on it. It's Rich Kleiman, a friend of the show, businessman, a partner, a manager with Kevin Durant as well, and he joins us now on the Michael K. Show. Rich, how are you doing? You staying safe?
I am doing well, guys. Thank you. I'm staying safe. I'm healthy. I'm fortunate in that regard. And I'm with my family, so I've been enjoying the time being kind of quarantined with them. You said that's not why I came on the show. I came on the show because I'm supposed to be a regular co-host.
That's right.
What I was told by you guys.
Yeah, you know what? This whole thing threw everything into flux, though. You know, we'll have to revisit.
Rosenberg told me you didn't really want me on anymore.
No, that was Don.
Oh, Don.
Why would I say that? Did I say that to you?
Not out loud.
I say everything out loud. You know that.
So what do you think, Rich? I think, of course, the guys that have a chance to win a championship, they want to come back. Do you think that the guys on the bottom teams that have no chance to make the playoffs really want to come back for 9 or 10 games to get it up to 70 so they could have the RSNs pay the most money?
Well, I think everyone wants to come back, to be honest with you, because I think they love basketball. I saw Trae Young post a few days ago. I mean, these younger guys who are on some of these teams and aren't making the playoffs, I think they want to play basketball. I also think that if they do come back, there hasn't been any indication that it's going to come back in the same format in which the season ended. So I think that there's some intrigue as well to what, like, this unconventional setup will be when they return, if they're playing in one destination, if it's tournament format, whatever it may be. I think overall people know how important sports are to the culture and society. So I think everyone feels this, like, feeling of, if they go back, I'm going to go do my job and be a part of it. And, I think for the most part. Now, are there teams that deep down inside are probably thinking, like, I saw Steve Kerr's quotes about, we're taking the season as if it's over. Do I think operations of teams want to get everything back and started and kind of figure out what the safety measures are to get back when they're 57 games below 500? Probably not, no. But I think they'll all do it if they have to.
I guess the scary thing from a team standpoint, Rich, would be, all right, well, I'm not making the playoffs. You want me to come back and try to finish up the season so you can crown a champion, and then you might affect my bottom line next year, right? Because if we go deep into this thing where maybe they have to delay the start of next year or trim the amount of games played for next year to fit it all in, I could see teams saying, wait a minute, I'm not making the playoffs anyway. Why should I sacrifice my bottom line for next year too?
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, I think the starting later next year, I honestly think, you know, I've heard it tossed around before. I think it's interesting. And a lot of things in this kind of dark time and with the league stopping, I think there's a lot of things that you can try to take advantage of in terms of implementing certain things into the game and implementing certain things into the league and the format that you may have been waiting to speed up, but now is the time. And I think that for some of these players, if they have to start later next year to get back on the court now, they'll deal with it. Where I think it's a somewhat open-ended kind of conversation is with players that have come out of college that stop playing at the end of February, early March, and if the season doesn't start till next December, when are they playing organized basketball again? When are they playing competitive basketball again? That's a 9-10 month break. Mm-hmm. But to your question, I think, yeah, it's a real thing to think about for players that come back after this long a period of time to play quickly, and if you get hurt and it affects your personal season next season, that's scary, but that's the risk always. But I saw Chris Paul said that he thinks players need at least 3 to 4 weeks, and I think that sounds right. I mean, game shape for us, like getting ready to go play at the gym, we can't even understand what game shape means. I think that those are some of the questions that everyone's probably asking, but I think getting back in the court is worth it for everybody.
Do you get updates from the Nets periodically? What's that like relationship like at this point?
Well, what's up, Rosenberg? How are you?
Hey, Rich. How are you?
I get updates in that these are friends of mine. Like, I speak to Adam because he's a friend of mine, and I don't try to get any proprietary information. But, you know, I'm in a conversation where I hear things that are being tossed around and ideas being tossed around. But, you know, only with the Nets as it regards to, like, me and Sean are friendly and we check in with each other and he checks in on how Kevin's doing if he hasn't spoken into a day or two. But not, like, asking me or anyone saying, hey, this is what's going to be announced in 2 weeks. Like, I think everybody's taking it a day at a time.
What kind of texter is Adam Silver? Tell us. Is he solid? Does he seem like an old guy texting, or does he seem like a young guy texting?
Oh, not at all like an old guy, man. Not at all. You know, I mean, that's, you know, I mean, Adam Silver is the idea, the reason why he's so successful, in my opinion, is he's incredibly educated, and he's informed and, like, topical. Like, he knows what's going on in everything. And I think he's probably kept up with his iPhone skills as part of that. And he's a pretty good texter, man.
Now, you mentioned Kevin. Kevin Scarily did get the coronavirus. So how is he doing? Was it a tough go for him? And how is he doing rehab-wise?
No, he was very fortunate. He never had any symptoms, and he was cleared, you know, after that first 14-day period. I think what was scary was that it was like 2 days after Rudy Gobert and Donovan Mitchell. And at that time in our country, I think knowing anyone that had it, you know, Tom Hanks was scary. Like, hearing anyone's name mentioned, it was still so raw, and obviously it's still so frightening today, but unfortunately we've been desensitized a bit to the amount of people that we hear having it. And, you know, at that point it was just, like, so real. And then my kids, because they don't get it, when they hear Kevin got it, it has nothing to do with Kevin the basketball player. It's like Kevin my friend, so that seems even realer to them. So that whole time for a day or two was scary, but, you know, he never got any symptoms, and he isolated himself, and then when that period was over, just continued quarantining like everyone.
Now, is the fact that the NBA facilities are closed, has that set back Kevin in his rehab from his injury?
No. I mean, I think similar to, like, are you guys together right now, or are you guys all zooming in?
All zooming in.
Yeah.
No, actually by camera, but we're in separate spots.
Yeah, so, I mean, he's not doing a Zoom workout, but similarly, he's, you know, you got to adjust a bit, but I wouldn't say that his rehab's been halted in any way, shape, or form. I mean, everything is on a continued upwards trajectory.
If they come back in July, could Kevin play?
Could he play? When all this stopped, that kind of conversation didn't continue because there was just no reason to have that conversation. It just wasn't even on a list of priorities. And for Kevin and I, it doesn't feel like it makes any sense to have that conversation because it all seems so unrealistic. And I figure that if it wasn't unrealistic, that the conversation would be brought up. So, you know, my assumption is no. And I've kept saying that just because I haven't really had the conversation, and I don't think anything's changed.
It is interesting, though, Rich, because, you know, if the season were, you know, none of this ever happened, the season was going to start in October, he would start to really be ramping up in July. And I think it's interesting because, let's say, if Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant come back and play with the Nets team that's in the playoffs, they're not a long shot anymore. They've got a legitimate shot to make some noise. Is that appetizing to him? Is that enticing to him?
I don't know. I think that this is a long game, you know, like, I haven't spoke to him about that scenario, so I can't answer it. But what I would say is that I don't think he would be making that decision in a vacuum. And, you know, he's coming off a serious injury, a long period of time. And, when they come back to play, we don't even know what that looks like. I don't even know how a season after taking 2 or 3 months off can resemble the way it was left. I mean, imagine it's like starting a whole new season. So, and I think there's just too many variables for him to think to himself, like, okay, in a vacuum, if I come back with this team, we can get a chip. Like, I don't think he can think that way. And again, haven't had the conversation with him, but I think if you're a Net fan or you're a fan of the game, you know, it's a long game with him. He just missed an entire season of NBA basketball. One of the best players, in my opinion, to ever play. And, like, you don't rush that back to, like, fit into a condensed season. But again, haven't had the conversation with him.
the post-coronavirus world just seems murky to me, Rich, and especially you as a businessman. How long do you think it will take, not just for fans to come back and watch the sport, but for it to be viable again, for it to be what it was? Can it get right back to what it was before it all happened?
Well, I mean, in the short term, I definitely think the answer is no. And I think that, to what I was saying earlier, I think that what positives we have to take from it are you use it as an opportunity to better each sport. Use it as an opportunity to better each in-arena experience, in-stadium experience, at-home experience, how you give fans content and coverage and play-by-play, because you can now. This is when you have to get creative. And then I think even when maybe we're told that it's okay to be back in a stadium, imagine that's a year from now, a year and a half from now. What's going to be like embedded in our mind a bit will be this societal change of social distancing and not being in large groups. So do I think people are going to rush back into a stadium? I don't think so, because I don't even think it's like you're going to get your vaccine in the mail, like all 300 million people in the world, billion, right, which are going to games. So, no, it's going to be a long process. But I think that sports is like pandemic-proof and anything proof, and that people will love that and love live sports and love the competition and the story and the intrigue. And clearly we're all becoming more adept at using technology in everything we do, you know, so I think it'll play an even bigger part of the experience as a fan, and you know, that'll evolve, but the excitement will be the same.
Funny to think about, Rich, the last time I ran into you, I think that was the first time that, like,
oh my God.
It was the first time I saw someone I knew. We ran into each other, and I went naturally to go approach him, and he gave me like a back off. What are you doing? And I think it was the first time. I was like taken aback at first, and to think of how naive I was at that moment. We had no idea, and you were being serious but a little tongue-in-cheek, to think that like you would never approach someone in that way anymore.
No, the funny thing is, that is hilarious. That might be like the day before we all just stopped, right?
No, it was the day. That was the 11th.
That's crazy. So I've been reading about this for so long. I'm not saying I was some like prognosticator, but I got caught up in this, like reading about this on a plane ride in the end of January. I remember NBA All-Star Weekend, like deep in my phone in the morning, reading about the virus. My brother and I have that like relationship where we'll talk about sports back and forth all day, and like we got into talking about what we were watching with this virus. It still felt like, obviously, all this is happening, but it can't happen in America. When I saw you, it was the Who were having a press conference, and I was like just learning all the different groups and the things I was learning about the disease and how news was broken, and I started listening to the Who's press conference when they officially labeled it a pandemic, and then here you are come walking up the stairs, and I'm like, nah, man, no more. Don't even come close to me right now.
I know.
Makes perfect sense to me with Peter.
Well, yeah, I just thought it was because of that, because it was me, but no, apparently it was this. And I just, you know, especially, you know, Rich, coming from the world that you come from in music and where I am, you know, like dapping people up and like extended hugging and, you know, just holding on to people's hands and arms around people. Like, Rich, can you imagine running into Busta Rhymes right now? Like, there are certain people who their way of interacting is so physical. And I just wonder whether that will ever be considered normal behavior again.
Well, no, I cannot imagine running into Busta Rhymes right now. That's first answer. Number two, I don't know if you saw the clip the other day they had up on the internet of Luka Doncic and J. Cole having a conversation, and they, within the conversation, had given each other like a record-breaking 11 pounds.
I didn't see that.
There's a voiceover explaining what each pound was. Like that in the conversations, there's like the hello again, yo, you've been doing a lot of great work, man.
Of course.
Maybe we just reached the pinnacle of all that anyway, and like it's over. I think those kind of changes are not going to be as hard for people to get over, to be honest with you. I think in the grand scheme of things, I think maybe, you know, those are changes that people like Dr. Fauci thinks we always should have made.
Right.
is weird, though. Like, at least we don't have to dap up 800 people when you go out anymore, man. Look at that silver lining.
That's true. That's
now,
very
Rich,
true.
Tell me about the this show you have coming up on Showtime. What's it about?
It's called Basketball County, and tagline, In the Water. And it's about a little bit of the history and origin of Prince George's County, where Kevin's from, but really about the amount of basketball players, men and women, and talent in general that's come out of this region, especially in like the last 20 years, but dating all the way back in the 80s and 70s. And it's just like Jerry and Grant, Jeremy Grant, Oladipo, Quinn Cook, KD, Jeff Green, Michael Beasley, Alex English, Len Bias. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And it kind of just tells a story about the evolution of, like, youth basketball and how that kind of became a haven for kids in the inner city there. But the story's rare in the amount, the sheer amount, and just, like, it's a great story about a county. Now, look, there's tons of them all over the country that probably feel that same way about theirs, but this was an important story to tell, and it's coming out on Showtime on May 15th.
Was that always the timeline? Was it going to be May 15th no matter what?
Yeah, yeah. No, in from that regard... no, I mean, not always, but it wasn't like a COVID release date. And the Marbury doc as well, you know, ended up coming out while people were all at home. And, you know, he was benefited in that regard because I think a lot of people needed to see that story. And I was excited that it got so many eyeballs. But no, it wasn't sped up for that purpose. We have sped up, you know, tons of boardroom content and conversation and, you know, felt like we would do our part to create as much entertainment and distraction. And it's, you know, it's a brand that we're building that felt like it had to continue to have a conversation during this time. So, you know, some things have changed as a business for sure.
Have you enjoyed The Last Dance? Have you watched it at all?
Oh, my God. I've loved it. And this Sunday that I heard episode 6 about Nick Bulls rivalry, which I can tell you everything that happened in every game of every one of those series. So I'm excited for that. It's going to be crazy.
It's been great. It's been great. We're glad that you're healthy. We thank you for joining us as always. And stay safe and keep in touch, please.
Thank you, guys. Stay safe as well.
Thanks, Rich.
Later, Rich.
All right.
That is Rich Kleiman, friend of the show, businessman. Man about town, manager, partner, Kevin Durant, a lot of things.
I'm proud that I've made it to the point on the show where I've now contributed friends of the show.